Ladies and gentlemen, look who is about to enter into the studio. The wonderful Mia Isabella is here. Welcome to Jim Norton and Sam Roberts. Hello. Mia.
Hi.
How are you?
Oh, great. Thank you.
Oh. Is it tough to get around New York today because of the parade?
I think they had a couple of the streets blocked off.
Yeah, it's really annoying. Do you celebrate Columbus Day? Do you celebrate Christopher Columbus?
Let me wake up before I start answering questions.
Right. So
I don't make the mistake of saying something
ridiculous. Yeah. Ridiculous.
Well, no, I don't celebrate it, but there's not a particular reason why.
Just because it's yeah.
Because it's not something that I think about all the time. Like, oh, it's Columbus Day's coming up. Yay.
I only think about it when I'm getting fucked in traffic, like today. Like, why is this happening? The street's blocked. Oh, it's Columbus Day.
Right. Right.
Oh, that's why.
So what do you got going on, Mia?
Oh gosh, a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like what?
Well,
I'm not going to take your word for it. You're going to have to.
We're going to launch my own show soon, a podcast that I'm going to start on. And hopefully the goal is to work with SiriusXM one day and have my own in-studio show.
Oh, yeah. What's the premise of the podcast?
Since We're Being Honest
is
the name of the show. And it's really my way of being able to actually address a lot of different misunderstandings, relationships, situations in the media, my life, and representing my community, LGBT, trans people especially.
How did trans people take to you? Are you somebody that
they like me? Oh, sorry.
Go ahead.
Yeah, no, I thought you were.
Well, you're just a great customer, Jim. But
everyone loves her.
Yeah. The trans community loves Jim because he pays into the community so well.
I certainly do. They call me the college fund.
Oh, Lord.
But how do they take to you? Do they hold you in high esteem or not?
I have a lot of friends in this industry. I've grown up in the industry as a young adult with trans people,
mm-hmm.
In the trans adult industry. So I've got to know a lot of people's personal stories, their real lives, their careers as well. So I'd say I have a lot of friends in the industry that respect me for sure.
Does it surprise you? Because I always you hear about it more with celebrities, but if it's happening with celebrities, it's happening with civilians. You're just not hearing about it. The amount of people who this is what they like, they get off on a trans woman, but in public they'll be very anti-trans. They won't talk about it. If anything, they'll be discriminatory about it. Like,
so
isn't it amazing how often it happens though?
I mean, I was amazed in my own personal situation once, but because that person that I was involved with actually never was a secret in Hollywood. Like, we hung out publicly all the time.
So what surprised you?
Well, when it became like a big media fuss, then it was more like, oh, God, we should be quiet now. You know what I mean? But I guess that was because people have their teams and lawyers and advising them in the ways that they feel it's appropriate to handle situations.
Oh, so the minute people started becoming aware of stuff, all of a sudden it's not really...
When it was spin negatively.
Right, I see.
Then it was like, oh, God. We should probably be quiet now. I'm like, oh, 3 years later.
And that's when publicists and people get involved, as
crisis
opposed to
management, attorneys.
I don't know. Why is it a crisis, though? Like, who cares? Like, I don't know why they consider it a crisis.
Yeah,
it's not a big deal.
It's odd, especially now, because like it's really not a big deal anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, it's newsworthy. But it's not like this stigmatizing thing that stops your
career. I don't even think
career.
It's newsworthy. Like, in the sense of, like, all right, this is who you date. It's only newsworthy if you're dating somebody who's, like, underage. You know what I mean? Like, when Jerry Lee Lewis married his 13-year-old cousin, that's newsworthy.
You consider
and
that
hot.
Newsworthy?
I don't understand why they obsess over it, though.
Well, you're, I mean, look.
Coming from me, that's saying something.
you're obsessed with whoever celebrities are dating regardless. So if it turns out that there's some kind of extra...
gift?
Thing or gift or kink or whatever it is.
That's very true.
Like, it's gonna be, it is something that you're at least curious about.
So what exactly is one of the things that publicly you think that people got wrong? You're saying that there's all these stories that people
got
wrong.
Well, you know me. You've known me for a long time, and you've known a little bit about some of the drama and different relationships. One of the most important things I never really publicly addressed in a major way was the relationship with Tyga and the Kardashian situation and how all that got spinned and turned around. And there was a lot of mistruths.
That became a huge story because
it was outrageous.
All
what
of
was
a sudden,
mistruth? Yeah.
You get involved. So for those that don't like the public story.
Yes.
Was, and this is very brief, that you were, that Tyga was cheating on Kylie Jenner, right?
Mm-hmm.
With you.
Yes, and he was.
And he Well,
there you go. Today right. I said it.
And then they, whatever. And then it became a social media thing. And
but
all
that
this
really
stuff.
Wasn't the whole subject of the situation. Someone was impersonating me on Instagram. They made like 20 different Instagram accounts and they were threatening to release some sex tape, which doesn't exist to my knowledge because mm-hmm. we never shot a sex tape, at least not aware of such a thing. And someone was threatening to like extort, to, you know, release this sex tape. They didn't give this money. It was psycho. It was insane. The world was like coming at me so hard. And I never addressed it because I didn't want to like make any wrong decisions, say the wrong things. I really just wanted to protect him in every way that I could.
But are you, let me ask you, did you out him?
No.
Okay. Because I'm saying people said you the out
lawyers,
people.
As far as his lawyers were concerned and what they told me, when they were working with my lawyers. And by the way, I was under strict settlement negotiation agreement or negotiation situation the entire time.
Settlement for?
They were trying to buy me in confidentiality. Okay. And I wouldn't agree to anything. I didn't want any money from him. I just wanted him to tell the truth so I could move forward with my life.
Let me ask you, when you say you wanted him to tell the truth, you wanted him to admit that you guys were together?
He didn't even have to admit that. I gave him a written statement and everything that he could have just did a joint statement saying that we were just friends. People just made up this salacious story and, you know, standing up for, you know, trans rights, simply saying, you shouldn't discriminate against my friend because we're friends, blah, blah, blah. I made it easy for him. But apparently he had already lied and said he didn't know me. To whoever he was dealing with, but his attorneys and my attorneys knew the truth.
But you didn't out him.
No, I didn't. As far as his attorneys said to me that his phone was hacked and the messages, they told the public the messages were not real. His penis pictures were real because those were released, mm-hmm. but that his phone was hacked and they were trying to figure out who the hacker was. So I never outed anyone.
Wait, his phone was hacked. I don't know what you mean.
They said that the messages weren't real, that someone took either that he was hacked and someone took the nude pictures of him. And release them, or that someone that he was seeing that wasn't me released the
like one of the fake accounts or whatever.
No,
it was.
Not the fake accounts. One of someone else that he had dealt with before Jesus. Me, like a regular,
oh,
like
I
a
see.
Normal genetic girl.
I see
that he had sent in confidence these pictures, had released them or something of the sort.
Why is there so much embarrassment about it from these guys?
Well, the world did humiliate him. The world was attacking him. So I did understand at the time, and I was trying my best to be as cool as possible about it and be really protective of
but
him.
But they didn't humiliate him. Like, why not just say, like, yeah, this is who I am, and this. If you get caught cheating, getting caught cheating stinks. No one, I've gotten
true.
Caught, it's embarrassing.
And but it's
I got caught too, though.
You were in a relationship?
I was in a relationship, so it was embarrassing for me. And my person was high profile, more so than him. So that's another reason why I stayed quiet.
Who were you in a relationship with?
I will not tell you that.
What kind of job? You don't have to say what they did. Or who
I'm
they
not
were.
Gonna say that no? either because it's already some things are public, so it'll be easy to kind of connect the dots.
Okay. Oh, yeah, okay.
Since I'm known as an outer, isn't that funny?
Right.
Yeah, but no,
but I've never told.
People have said that, so I'm asking about it just because people have said, like, is there a part of you when you're with somebody like that who's really famous and goes like, fuck, I want people to know this?
No, absolutely not, because I'm a really private person in my real life. And I like my privacy. I liked being able to be Mia in a certain situation, but be able to walk down the street just as a normal girl.
Mm-hmm.
I adore that. That's something that a lot of famous people don't. You can get that back. Once you become super high profile, you'll never be able to get that back.
So how did you end up hooking up or dating with all these famous people?
They contact me. They find me. I used to be a very well-known porn star, uh-huh. you know? So it's not that hard to find me and contact me or my publicist or different people. And they do that often. Wow. Even now, still, to this day.
And now, so you turn people down?
All the time.
Wow.
Especially after what I went through.
Yeah.
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 Are there any of them that just like, hey, I want to date publicly?
Yeah. I the guys that I've dated were never, like, it wasn't a secret thing that we only met in the bedroom.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
We would hang out at parties. We would go to my friend's place. We had friends around. That's why another reason is that I stayed quiet, because there were a lot of people that had already been around us publicly, that had even people had been in our bedroom together. And they were going to come out and start having their own little stories and their little scripts and storylines of my life. And I was like, no, I'm just going to be quiet so I don't get any more sensationalization. So that was not true.
So
did
you
not release anything.
Oh, okay. So did you guys not settle anything? You had no legal
settlement? I didn't
want
a settlement with him. I didn't want any money from him.
Cool.
I just wanted my respect. I wanted the truth to be told. I didn't have to even say that we were having a sexual relationship or anything of the sort. I just wanted my name to be untainted that way.
Explain,
that's all I asked for.
Explain the sex tape thing to me. So he...
It's when somebody videotapes you fucking.
I understand.
Oh,
yes.
Sorry.
But like, so he thinks you're trying to sell this thing, but wouldn't he know that it didn't exist because you never shot one?
Well, years ago, I had a roommate, Capri Anderson was her name.
Okay.
We became friends. We were shooting a pilot for a show here in New York. And I ended up moving to L.A. We ended up becoming really good friends. We ended up being roommates. And during some argument that we had, and she had met him before, he'd been over her house many times, hung out, drinking, smoking, just relaxing. She had a little security camera in the house, which I didn't know. And when she was angry one day, she was like, she was going to go through this camera and release footage of us. When she made that threat years ago, I contacted him immediately. And we came up with how we would handle a situation like this if it ever arised.
I see.
How were you going to handle it if it arose?
How we're going to handle it? We're going to simply say that we were just friends. Okay. And that, you know, we worked together through the fashion sense, because I actually have a fashion entity and business before I was ever in porn.
Oh, it wasn't sex footage. It was just you guys sitting there.
Well, no, that she had threatened that she had footage, whatever the footage might have been, that she was going to release something. But there wasn't any footage. And you know how I know there wasn't any fucking footage? Because when I found the camera, I put something in front of it. So anytime that he would come and hang out with me, that I would put a card or something in front of that house.
Where was the camera?
Somewhere in the living room. So I would always put something in front of it.
Was it facing the couch?
I think so. Yeah.
Oh, well, yeah. Yeah. See, I have a security camera in my house too,
yeah.
And it aims at the front door only. Meaning, if people come in when I'm not there, there's footage of it. But it doesn't go beyond the first foot of the front door.
Well, it was facing from the living room towards the front door, where the couch was in one of the.
But it's one of those things where you're getting
right.
You're purposely getting the house because you want to capture what's going on. And like, there's ways to do a security camera where. Like, you know, literally, you only get the front door.
Of course.
If you walk into my house, there's a video. And then it ends 1 foot in.
Right.
Like, that's it. It's yeah. just, it's in case I'm away and somebody comes in, I can see who comes in my house. But there's nothing private captured.
Right.
Right.
Well, there was never a sex tape. There was never, like, to my knowledge, I've never seen any footage of he and I together.
And I would imagine that by now it would have been out.
Of course.
Right.
People were trying to sell this fake sex tape that did not exist. All the media was freaking out really over that. Once they saw penis pictures, sex tape, trans, it was like,
it's a great story.
And then a Kardashian. And
yeah.
You throw that in and it's like, oh my God, it's a sensationalized situation.
Yeah.
And it was extremely frightening. But like I said, hashtag since we're being honest, my new show coming soon, I'll be answering all kinds of stuff like this and telling the absolute truth, because obviously being quiet for everyone else's benefit didn't do me any justice
right.
in my life. So it's time.
Has
to
it hurt you though,
back.
Being quiet for their benefit?
Yes, it destroyed a lot of my credibility. It destroyed a lot of business opportunities that I had, and a lot of relationships with people that trusted me and cared for me and thought that some of this stuff might have been true.
And their biggest, people's biggest fear, I guess, with this is being outed. Like being, like, it's really weird how the biggest fear.
Don't do something you don't want to get caught doing. That's simple.
That's true. I mean, we all do it on some level, but the biggest fear people have is this shame, like being ashamed about stuff.
Somebody like
that's gonna make me feel ashamed. And when you walk it through logically, what's the worst that can happen if people know?
Well, here's the thing:
they just look at you and go, "Oh, that's what that person
likes." Once you tell
the
truth, no one can hurt you with it.
Yeah,
but you've got Tyga, who's a rapper, who like, and in hip hop and in that entire community, it's way.
I know, taboo.
Bigger of a deal.
Why don't they cut it out?
Than anywhere else. Or even like, if it's an athlete,
go
into a locker room, it's
a
way bigger deal.
Yet a huge percentage of black culture and
right.
hip-hop culture love trans people and that
lifestyle.
Do they? Oh, yeah. So it was very interesting.
Yeah. I mean, the part of me is like, why do you care? And like, and I hate seeing people outed because it's like, you know, like we were going to interview a woman who had dated an Olympian. And she was outing him about, like, oh, he was my, and.
You didn't want to.
We had
fuck
her booked
bitch,
and then we canceled
the
her. What's that?
Fuck that bitch, by the way. I know who she is.
But we canceled her.
And she wasn't dating him. She fucked him once.
Maybe.
There's
but she. I still didn't like that she was, I mean, this has been a bigger story before we got to it. But I didn't like that she was just mentioning him and outing. I was like, yeah.
Right. And she was actually like, owning. She was like, no, I am going out in public because I'm going to out him. This is what I'm doing now.
And
this
that's
is my
how
business.
You can tell that that person didn't have high morals or any kind of real care for that person ever.
Right. Whereas you are sitting there going like, this becomes a story. It becomes a public thing. And when it becomes a public thing, not by your doing.
Yeah.
You start getting lied about.
It was
so you've got no other option than to come forward and say, no, no, no. All right, fine. Here's the story. I wasn't going to say it. Here's the story.
Even a year later. every time I turn around, there's like Google alerts and there's all kinds of people putting out articles. Like even a year later when I'm not doing anything,
right?
No press for it, not discussing it whatsoever. It's constantly, I'm constantly being tagged and dragged and stuff. So it's like, okay.
But it has raised your profile. On some level, you have to like it because it's like, it's not, they're not saying you're a shitty person.
Well, how did it benefit me at all?
When you become
financially destroyed me, personal relationships, the person that I was actually in love with, I had to walk away from.
Why?
Because I didn't want that happen to him. I didn't want him to be publicly shamed like that. I didn't want him to experience what that felt like for the other person.
But why public shaming if the person is open about, meaning if you're dating someone and you're dating that person and all of a sudden, hey, you both like each other and you're dating, where's the shame in it?
I get it. When you have a major contract, when you have endorsements, when you have other things going on in life, I am understanding to the idea that society has not completely accepted us.
You got
to
protect a brand.
I'm very understanding to those things. You know what I mean? I definitely took those things into consideration. And it wasn't that we were particularly cheating. We had been seeing each other for a few years. But I believe during the time that he had started dating this girl, and he didn't tell me anything about her.
You're talking about Tyga right now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We had at least spent a couple of times together during the time. Depending on when they started dating.
Right.
I was seeing him since 2013.
Mm-hmm.
Until right before all this stuff happened.
Yeah.
And then I found out. So
how'd
course,
you meet?
How we meet? He contacted me through one of his friends when I went to one of the concerts and asked to see me.
It's amazing how often that happens, and that's the way it happens. And then, like,
see, that's a different message. I just took, like, wow, it must be cool to be a rapper.
Yeah. You just start rhyming words in your head, going, maybe I can make a career out of this.
Yeah,
but I wasn't angry at him. You know what I mean? Like, I wasn't angry at him. I didn't feel like he was a bad guy. I still don't.
Mm-hmm.
People just mishandled the situation. A lot of people didn't know the truth. So whoever were doing their job for him obviously didn't know any of the true details of the situation. So they just thought, someone's bucking with him. Let's take her down.
Yeah.
So I tried to understand that. But then at the same time, I have your lawyer and my lawyer discussing things every single day for a month or more. And you're telling me to be quiet.
Who mentioned it first?
Who mentioned what?
The whole thing.
The whole situation. I have no idea. It was released to the text messages and pictures were released to someone, and it ended up in somebody's blogs and articles, and it just spread like wildfire. I woke up to my Instagram literally blowing up. That's how I found out.
So you didn't release the text messages?
No, it's still to say there's. I have asked them to say that publicly numerous times. They knew that I did not release anything. There's no proof and no such thing because it didn't happen from me. They were saying that his phone was hacked or someone else released the stuff. So how the hell did I release anything? But that basic truth and statement that his attorney said, it was sent from someone else, that nude picture. If that's the case, from my text messages, how the hell did I release them? If you're saying that I didn't do it off the top. But they didn't make it a big deal. They kind of just threw that tidbit in really quickly.
And you'd have to imagine, like, if they knew that you released it, you would have been sued like crazy by now, right?
Of course.
Yeah. The fact that you haven't been is probably the most...
They didn't... There's nothing they could have done to me.
Right. Right. Who are you going to do the podcast with? Do you have a...
I haven't decided exactly yet. I have a couple of people that have offered me opportunities to work with them. But I think one of my co-hosts to start with is going to be Al Roker Jr., who works with Mancow, the Mancow Show.
Okay.
To give that kind of male perspective.
Al Roker's son?
I don't think that's his son. Maybe it is.
Unless it's a character name.
Is he black or white?
He's black. He works with Mancow. He's worked with him for a long time.
I'm thinking of
the... I worked with him with Fox. I worked with him with Mancow when Mancow was with Fox. And now... with his show that he does with the
station. I think you meant the newscaster, Al Roker's son.
It's probably a character name.
How stupid am I?
Mancow is probably like, you look like Al Roker. I'm going to call you Al Roker Jr.
Oh, there you go. Okay.
You see?
That might be his radio
smart.
Name.
They're just putting the pieces together.
You better be glad you've got this guy.
Yeah.
No, it's got to be his son. His name's Al Roker. That's Al Roker Jr.
I thought that was his real name.
I think it'll be a great perspective for a male perspective.
Uh-huh. I don't know.
He's worked with him so long, and he's going to be a little bit brash, you know, more than I would normally be.
Uh-huh.
So I feel like it'll be a great...
Where are you going to tape? Oh, yeah, that's right. You're Chicago.
I'm back in Chicago.
Okay.
And it'll be interesting.
Okay.
It should be fun.
Yeah.
I get to address a lot of stuff. And
Well, yeah, what are you going to do? Like,
I'm going to bring proof on. I'm going to discuss a lot of different things.
Are you going to bring proof? Give an example of something you're going to bring proof on about.
They're just going to have to tune in.
Well, hashtag you have to get them to, trust me, they'll listen if they know what they're going to hear.
You'll find out then.
How many stories are there? Like, are you just going to do, like, are you going to be able to do, like, a whole bunch of podcasts? Just
it's
like,
not even just about that. Like I said, I want to address some things and some truths, but more than anything, I want to talk about the lifestyle. I want to talk about, like you said, the relationship situations that trans people deal with and their personal stories. I want to delve into a lot of different people's backgrounds, and it's going to be very interesting.
Yeah.
Well, starting when?
Because girls are going to tell me a lot of things they wouldn't tell.
Starting when?
We're going to start shooting it in the next couple of weeks.
Oh, okay. So now do you think that girls are going to be going on just outing people?
Well, I would hope not, because that's not the premise of my show. I want you to be honest, and I want you to feel like you can do whatever you feel the need to do and express yourself, but I don't think that a lot of girls are going to come on there just to drop their celebrity names.
But if they do?
That'll be their story to tell.
Okay.
It's their prerogative.
It's their prerogative. It's how you handle things, how you handle it.
Oh, there's going to be a long line. There is going to be a long fucking line.
You think so?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Well, yeah, you're right.
A long line.
The other name that you get linked up with a lot, and it's especially been happening more because he's been in the news, is Colin Kaepernick.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something you're going to be addressing on the podcast? Is there a story to address there?
I'll take my time with that.
Yeah.
That's somebody that I respect extremely.
You actually have
care for extremely. I think it's an incredible person. The braveness that he's showing now, I admire, and mm-hmm. I feel like I maybe had something to do with making him feel bold enough to be the kind of person he's become lately.
How did you do that?
We had a great friendship, great connection, and we talked a lot. I'll say that.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. I have a lot of friends. No one ever inspired me to not stand during the national anthem.
I'm working on it.
Well,
I've had a few that would inspire me to kneel. Oh.
Yeah, that's what she's talking about.
No, I do get linked to him a lot because during the Tyga situation, someone saw some kind of social media.
By the way, I should point out something that you were like. Okay, I had this plan with Tyga, and
right,
it was,
and then I just
if we ever got exposed, we would just tell everybody that we were really good friends.
Oh, shit.
And then I was like, hey, what about Colin Kaepernick? And you're like, well, friends. I'll say we're just really good friends. I'm like, okay, well, that kind of explains that
you
one away.
You can take it how you want it, I guess.
Right, right.
I'm probably turning red now, aren't I?
No.
It's okay.
You look very comfortable.
Yeah.
You look very confident in your assertion.
But you do? You think you inspired him to be bold?
He inspired me. I think even during the situation that I was going through, mm-hmm. This was a person who made sure to keep in contact with me and made sure to kind of just make me feel like I could stand up to anything. And I think it was probably an important moment for him as well to see how the world was reacting to me and how people were kind of just really trashing me and how I was still trying my best to stand as tall and represent and protect people. I was at a really extremely low point. I was frightened.
Is that because it was after the Tyga stuff
I was
happening?
Frightened during the Tyga. I mean, I was so afraid of what was happening. I didn't know what was going on. Like I said, when you're dealing with crisis management people contacting you and attorneys and PR people and all the media, like every show out there, I'm on TMZ, I'm on UNLC, all this stuff happening, and I'm just like, what in the world is going on? Anybody that I've ever met, even from kindergarten, was trying to contact me. It was just not a fun time for me. And I almost gave up.
Did the lawyer threaten you?
They couldn't really threaten me. Well, they threatened Lainey. They threatened her. That if, in the beginning, they threatened her, if she released any statements on my behalf to protect my brand and my name, that they were going to sue her. For millions of dollars, for basically shut the fuck up. And once they said that to her and I saw those emails, I was like, okay, you fucked with the wrong one. Now I'm going to do a press conference because you don't threaten my people. You don't threaten my friends. You don't do stuff like that. And then they started to understand that I wasn't going to be pushed around. And then they came the let's try to buy her silence, which he should have known that wouldn't have worked. He's known me for years. He knows bullying does not do anything but piss me off. He knows that I didn't need the money. You know, like, what was I going to... You're already labeling me an extortionist, okay? You're letting it out there in the public eye that I am having a hold of this sex tape and I'm trying to extort someone that I care about. So you're already letting that be flown around in the media and spin so that I'm the villain. The villain.
Mm-hmm.
And then privately, you're trying to, please, I'll do anything. You know, just help us out. Just follow whatever we want you to do. And I'm like, why would I do that after you're out there publicly tainting my name?
And that's what he wants you to do, is like, just agree with us tainting your name.
Yes,
so that way I'll look
wanted.
Good.
I was being distorted.
Like, right, right.
Essentially.
So that's when Colin helps you out so much.
He just gave me confidence that I didn't have during that time. Like, he was still a friend and wasn't afraid to still contact me and wasn't afraid to check on me and wasn't afraid to give me some inspiration and wisdom and just telling me that he was proud of me and how I was handling it and that I wasn't that girl out there outing someone.
Did you find that certain people contacted you because they just wanted to make sure that that their secret was safe? did you get certain people?
I don't think they would feel like their secret would have been safe at that time when people were saying that I was doing all these horrible things. I don't think anybody would have felt safe at that time.
Yeah, but did anybody like from your past call you and be like, you're not
Anybody that knows me knows that I'm not capable of doing things like that.
You're not going to do stuff
like that.
It's just
not who I am.
Yeah.
I've been in the industry for 12 years. These are not the only high profile people that have been in my life.
Do you ever
trust me
when you're talking to whether it's a rapper like Tyga or an athlete like Colin?
Fuck all that. I've had billionaires that I've dated. I've dated royalty before. I've dated a prince before. Like, why would
Rupert
I?
Rupert Murdoch, right? Rupert Murdoch.
You dated Prince?
No.
Ooh.
Here goes the next story.
Ooh. Yeah.
No, I never dated Prince. I've dated a prince before. I've dated extremely. I like
Greta Van Susteren.
I like wealthy with discretion.
Yeah.
I usually don't prefer people with that kind of public notoriety, paparazzi chasing them down. I don't like that.
Do you have conversations with them? Do they talk to you and say, like, you know, this is amazing, but if anybody ever found out about this or...
No, because I'd be creeped out and I wouldn't want to fuck with them. If you're ashamed of me or make me feel weird in any way, I don't want nothing to do with you.
Right.
If
and
anything,
that's why
you're
it comes
the weirdo to me now.
Right.
Now I'm uncomfortable with you.
Yeah.
That's why it comes as such a shock when, like, it all turns against you and you're like, what the fuck? We were all having a good time.
Oh, right.
Right. I understand.
It was just a very interesting time, but it did inspire me to do this show and want to come.
Our show?
My
Thank
show.
Thank you.
Colin. Oh.
But yes, you too.
We felt good about it.
Anytime.
I thought Colin Kaepernick had inspired you to do our show.
Oh,
that
no.
That was nice.
So wait, it's going to be a great podcast that you videotape?
I would like to, yes. We're going to film it. And like I said, just kind of give me some practice to eventually be able to do my own show so I can be like Jim Norton one day.
Jim Norton, what? Failing miserably?
With the SiriusXM show.
Oh, okay.
Not the other stuff. By the way, that salad stuff is ridiculously hilarious.
Have you been watching
his
salad
show? Thank you very much.
I was like, what the hell is he doing?
I'm trying to get that picked up by NBC. There's a few networks have showed interest in Salad with Jim.
What networks have shown interest?
Why would I say that
now? Salad with Jim, you guys better give me a fucking show.
Salad with Jim is really good. It's intriguing. It's mysterious.
I want to promise something to you, Mia. Nobody has shown. You're the only person who's shown any interest in Salad with Jim.
That's not true. I'll show you the email.
Nobody has.
I'll show you the emails.
After the
show
sometime.
You have the emails, you have the proof.
Yeah, I do.
That's what I'm saying. They don't understand. When you have the emails, you have proof.
Oh, without a doubt. And they've asked me not to talk about it publicly, but I said, all right.
No, well, I mean, then congratulations on all your amazing success.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, no, it's just fantastic.
Yeah, they're really a hit.
It's just fantastic. Where are you going to do the? You're going to do the podcast in Chicago.
I'm going to do it in Chicago. We're looking through different studios to work with there. Like I said, it's really for me, it's a chance to have this kind of therapeutic way to just release a lot of things and heal.
You don't even need a studio, by the way. You could just do it.
They said from home I could do it and all that kind of stuff, but I want to do it in the studio. I want to really feel like I'm taking it very seriously because the goal is to one day do something like this
right.
on my own. So for me, this would be practice, but also it's going to be healing for me.
Right.
And it's going to be a way to, for other people like me, to be able to express themselves and to share their lives and their stories in a way that, like a girlfriend, like you would just tell your girlfriend things, you know?
When did you come out as trans?
I'm not.
First of all, I don't believe that. Second of all, I'm not asking you.
There was no coming out.
Yeah, Sam. Jesus.
I knew at 5 years old.
You did.
And I lived my life accordingly from that time.
Sam is not.
So I didn't
knowingly.
Have to do a coming out thing.
Yeah, and your parents were like, this is you, this is you.
My father was very protective and allowed me to be able to, and he made everybody scared. If it bothered me in any way or made me feel uncomfortable being me, that there was going to be a serious problem. So
that's really
lucky.
Amazing.
I was lucky. My mom, she took her a little while, but I've got to live my life this way.
Do you have brothers and sisters?
There's 15 of us.
What?
Oh my God.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
My mother has 5. I'm her eldest, and my father has 10 of his own.
Jesus.
Oh God, your dad's a busy guy, huh?
He's still popping him out. Like, I have a 2-year-old brother.
You
like,
do?
My oldest sibling, I think, is like 40 something, and then I have like a 2-year-old brother.
So you never talk to your dad. You never go, so what are you doing? You pretty much know.
Oh, I always am like, what the hell are you doing? Like, every time I hear a new story about him, I'm just like, oh, whatever. But I love him. He loves me. It's cool.
Do you get along with all of them? All 15?
Some of them we haven't met. but we know that they exist. Like, I have twins that are my age around the same time, and then I have a brother who's my age around the same time. So some of them we haven't met yet. Okay. Those are the ones we haven't met, but I get along with pretty much all of them.
Yeah, I mean, I got to be honest. Loved. Even if you didn't, I'd be okay with it, because I don't know if there's 15 people in general that I get along with.
Right.
So forget about the fact that they're all you. How did you, like, so your idea of what a family was when you were growing up was way left of center from the rest of us. Like from the beginning, it was like, no, it's kind of, the whole deal is non-traditional.
It felt very traditional to me.
It just made sense to you.
It all made sense to me. It all felt very traditional. I grew up very traditionally. I grew up in the South of Tennessee. I was born in Chicago, but I was raised in the South with a big family.
Uh-huh.
And we were very close. And we had, you know, those traditional Southern values that you're raised with when you're raised down in Tennessee in a place like that. So my upbringing was actually very traditional. I just wasn't the traditional element.
Right.
But everything else about my upbringing was traditional.
Were your mom and dad married or no?
Yes, they were.
They were mm-hmm. at that time.
Was your dad having another family at the same time?
He was doing his thing.
Wow.
Yeah.
Around the time after me. You know, they had already been together for a while before me. And then after me, he went and did his, you know.
So, like, at what age do you accept that, like, he's out doing his thing? Because most kids haven't figured out that sometimes, like, most adults haven't figured out that sometimes you just got to go do your thing.
I would hate
thing.
To
you
find out just, my dad was fucking the whole time. Like, oh,
I confused
no.
you guys a little bit because I forgot to add the element that the genetic father, I didn't meet until I was 18. My father that I grew up with and loved that allowed me to grow up into myself
yes.
was a different person from the genetic father.
Where's the genetic
gotcha.
Father?
Now, there we go. Catch
gotcha.
Up.
Gotcha.
So, I wasn't raised thinking that my father was running around cheating on my mother because that wasn't happening.
Where's the genetic father?
He's in Wisconsin.
Oh, do you get along with him?
I love him very
much.
All right. Oh, no, the genetic father's in Chicago. The father that I was raised to believe was my genetic father until 18 is in Wisconsin.
How'd they tell you?
Oh, my mom, she's epic. She went out one night. She had moved up north. She had been in Tennessee for a while, and I already moved up north. And she had come up there, and she had went out partying with her friends and had drinks and whatever. And she just nonchalantly comes back drunk, and she's just like, hey, I was just out getting fucked up with your dad. And I'm like, that's not possible. He's in Wisconsin. She was like, oh, no, honey, your real dad.
Oh no!
And you're 18,
and I was 18, and she just came in lit, like, "Oh yeah, I was having drinks with your real dad. I forgot to mention that."
So when you realize, like, when
okay,
when you realize your definition of your family over the last the first 18
right.
years is totally not it's not
yeah.
true.
A lie.
It's a lie.
Right.
Yeah,
the whole
lie. Like, does your brain explode? What happens?
No, my brain didn't explode. Like I said, I had a really good upbringing anyway, and much more than just what I found out later, but. I kind of looked at her like, you bitch, only you. Like, only you would go out, have drinks with my dad, and come back out of the blue like, oh, I forgot to tell you.
Did she realize she fucked up? Like, oh, no, I said that.
No, she thought it was funny.
Oh.
Did you think it was funny?
No, of course not.
Yeah. That's a weird joke.
I'm going to excuse myself and go talk to my grandmother and get some details.
Right.
That's an odd joke.
I'll talk to you when I absorb all this.
By the way, you've been involved in a 12-act play
right.
for the last 18 years.
Epic.
You think that that's a weird practical joke?
Yeah.
Felt like it.
It's a good, though. It's a good hidden camera spoof.
Only my mom does crazy stuff like that. I'll give her credit. You know
how long
I mean?
Did it take you to be like, that's you, mom. That's just mom being mom.
The first moment that she said it, I was just like, well, she's kind of drunk, so I'm not really going to take it seriously until I discuss it with my grandmother first, mm-hmm. because she obviously will know things that I...
She must have lied about other stuff, though, because you don't... The first lie you tell right. is not one of that magnitude.
She's very non-traditional. I'll give her that.
Right. So she is non-traditional.
Yeah, she's very... She's extra.
So she's non-traditional... But at first, she doesn't accept the fact that you're transgender when you're 5.
I think it's harder for moms initially because it's like, this is my firstborn son or whatever.
Right.
I mean, I guess you'd think that about dads, but...
That's what I would... Yeah.
No, it was more her. It was more her.
Huh.
My dad was just, you know, because again, he... I really wasn't his child. And he was aware that he couldn't have children, but he thought that he had had some kind of...
Wait, he couldn't have kids?
Yeah, the one that I grew up with. Yeah.
He was impotent?
I guess
so.
Was he impotent or sterile? There's a big difference.
Sterile.
Okay.
Does impotent mean you can't get a rod?
Are you kidding?
Yeah, of course. No, I don't know what. Yes, I don't know what impotent and sterile. I get. I just you can't have kids. I don't live in this world.
The world of intelligence? How do you not know what impotent is?
Well, I figured impotent.
How many times have I said that to you?
So here's the thing. It's not this deep concern of mine that I think. I think about it as often as you do.
No, impotent is when you can't get an erection. Sterile
is when you're shooting blanks.
Yeah.
Oh, God, right. I look at the screen and it says erectile dysfunction. You guys are hilarious.
Well, yeah. We got to get... last thing we want is false information out there.
Absolutely.
This is a
right,
show that...
Where, since we're being honest, you're just going to tell it.
We can't laugh unless we learn. That's the tagline for the show.
I see.
Yes, yes, yes.
And the tagline should be, you'll do neither to the audience. Wow, okay, so he was sterile. But wait, well, 10, you had 15 total.
My real father, yes.
Oh,
he has 10.
That's fucking confusing.
My real father has 10, my mother has 5.
Wow, as far as I'm concerned, my parents only fucked twice. Me and my sister.
So like your genetic father mm-hmm. was like maybe the most, you know, non- sterile person ever.
He's perhaps the most potent man ever.
Yes, his sperm couldn't be more potent.
He's still just popping him out. It's crazy.
Yeah. Where's this guy? Well,
it's like Anthony Quinn. He was in his 80s, still fucking. And the actor Anthony Quinn, still getting people pregnant.
Men can
80.
Get pregnant until the day they die. Right?
I know. It's great. I want to do that, like when I'm really old. Like I have no kids, uh-huh. but when I'm
and
really
wait till
old.
You're super old.
Yeah, when I'm in my late 80s, if they tell me I get stage 4 something, I'm just going to get someone pregnant and then drop dead. Leave them holding the bag.
Just be one last laugh.
Yeah, here you go. Ugh.
Gotcha.
Deal with that.
What was it like going to school then? You're a kid, and you're trans, and this is before trans was as sort of known as it is now.
Yeah, but it wasn't like I was running around elementary school in heels and stockings, uh-huh. you know what I mean? Like, I was a little cute, curly-headed, blonde kid with big old Bambi eyes. It wasn't like I was wearing a dress to class. I got to live my gender role throughout my life, you know. It wasn't like I was running around in full makeup and stuff like that.
Right, so you're not
so
putting on this
cool.
show. It was just
right.
who
I had
you
a great
are.
Upbringing in school. I was involved with a lot of things like orchestra and different programs.
What did you
stuff.
Play?
Violin.
Did you really?
Until I was 18.
Are you a good violinist?
I was. Thing about being a violinist, or usually any instrument, when you play it, it's something that you practice every day, at least a few hours a day. It's something that you don't stop doing. So when you don't play for like 8 years, I wouldn't say you're good.
What does Charlie Daniels play? I know it ain't the violin.
He's a fiddle.
A fiddle, okay.
Yeah. Oh.
He plays the fiddle.
Since we're being honest, what about all this shit about Charlie Sheen? Why is everybody saying that I was fucking Charlie Sheen and that I had a disease? That is not true.
Oh.
I didn't say that. You're looking at me like I said
but
that.
You knew about this story because I remember before.
I know. I asked you about it.
You didn't have sex with Charlie Sheen?
No, I did not have sex with Charlie Sheen.
Do you
I
know him?
Yes, he was a really good friend of mine.
But actually,
now I shouldn't tell all the details before this stuff.
But he's actually a good friend of yours.
He was
not like
a good friend.
He
was an amazing friend to me during the time that we were in a part of each other's lives.
Okay,
I haven't spoken to him in about 3 years, but yeah, he saved me from an abusive relationship. From a person that had gone out to Hollywood and gotten themselves on drugs. I was behind the scenes. I was being abused. I was dealing with all kinds of crazy stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And his friendship meant the world to me.
Mm-hmm.
He gave me the ability to have the freedom to express myself with my art. He was a backer to me. He took amazing care of me. So, yes, that part is true. But him and I have never had sex. Hmm. And I do not have any fucking diseases, people. That is one thing that was really hard to
Who
swallow.
Said you had diseases? I never heard
oh
of you had
my
diseases.
God, if you Google the situation with me and Charlie, after the Tyga stuff, it happened right after. It was like boom, boom, boom. They took it and started. I gave a statement. They contacted me because years ago, someone threatened to release a story before any of the Tyga stuff happened.
Mm-hmm.
Some girl had taken a picture of me over at Charlie's house and so gave it to the tabloids and said they were going to release this story about me. And there was a girl that was jealous because he'd spoiled the shit out of me. I was having a hard time. So the guy was like super nice to me. And these girls that were actually sleeping with him, and there I saw countless of them, little sluts, were jealous because he would be extra generous to me, super kind to me.
And you never slept with him?
No.
But
I
he
never
was just giving you
him.
Money because he's a good guy.
It wasn't even just about money. He was helping me to get away from an abusive situation. And I was no longer happy being in the adult industry. And I didn't want to feel trapped in that world anymore. He was the most amazing person. So,
do you think he was frustrated that he didn't get to have sex with you?
You know what? Honestly, I feel like he could have if he wanted to because I respected him so much and he was so good to me
mm-hmm.
that I was kind of pissed that he wouldn't sleep with me because he was sleeping with all these girls, movie stars and all this stuff, these penthouse pets or not penthouse pets, but just like, you know, centerfold chicks, gorgeous women. And I was just like, wow. Why are you always wanting me over here? Why are you always wanting to hang out with me? Why are we sitting up there like having
I have
this
a guess.
Great friendship? we have this great friendship, and he would tell me everything. So I knew a lot of stuff. I just didn't know about what he was going through. But I knew whatever it was something dark because I would always, like, I'd read my poetry to him, and he would tell me some of his poetry all the time. Like, he's a really good writer.
Is he a good poet?
Yeah, he's actually really good, but his stuff is scary.
What was one of his poems?
One of them was about, that really caught my eye, that made sense to me much later on when everything came out about him,
mm-hmm.
was something about the Grim Reaper. And he would read, he was like reading me this poem, and he didn't have to read it from anything. He just had it in his mind. And I remember him telling me, and I was just like, that's so sad. Like, you have everything a man could want in the entire world, and you have these dark thoughts. Like, I didn't know what was going on with him. Now, years later, when I found out what he was privately going through, he was going through during that time that I was his friend. So I was a part of his life during one of the darkest times for him and for me as well. And I believe in some kind of way I was meant to be there for him because I was kind of like a psychiatrist.
How'd you guys meet?
One of his girls invited me over, one of his girlfriends, because they were a fan of mine and they had all my sex toys. And they were using my sex toys. And she was like, wouldn't that be cool if we could get Mia Isabella to come over and hang out with us? So they had me come over and as like a, you know, an appearance to come and see him and meet him. And I get there and there's all these gorgeous girls hanging out and they're having sex with my sex toys. And I'm just kind of like in shock. I walk into this, you know, house and I'm just like, what the hell is going on here? But he was super friendly, super open, super warm-hearted, super just cool. Really, really cool. Like the coolest person I've ever met in Hollywood. It's funny to me that every girl that ever walked in that house had to sign a non-disclosure agreement. He never made me do that. He never made me feel uncomfortable. Wow. He never made me feel like I was a secret or anything bad about me. He was just the coolest person. And if he's listening to this or hears about this, I want to tell him thank you so much for what he did for me.
What do you suppose that was, Jim? You were guessing some of the reasons that he might have had her over and stuff?
Well, of course. You would think that we were sleeping together, but that wasn't true. That was not true.
That would have been my guess.
And honestly, he knew what he was going through at the time, so he definitely didn't. He was protecting me from that. I asked him once, like, why don't you sleep with me? Why don't you sleep with everybody else? Is there something wrong with me?
What did he say? Coughed.
He just looked at me and started smiling. He was like, I have a lot of respect for you. And I was like, okay.
But, yeah, but sleeping with someone doesn't mean you don't respect them.
Well, it does when you're
going through that
HIV.
Yeah.
Like.
Well, they said there was rumors that he didn't tell people. I obviously don't know the truth of that.
I don't know either. That's one of the things I don't know. But I know he was being blackmailed by people because he told me a lot of stuff.
Yeah, I heard there was millions. What were they blackmailing him for?
I don't know. I don't know what the things were for. I just thought there were different people that were blackmailing him for obviously.
Didn't he say like $10 million in blackmail? Fuck, man.
Over time, I'm sure it added up to be that much.
Well, I think he said that he was before he announced to the world that he had HIV or whatever, that he was getting blackmailed by people who were going to expose that.
Someone took a photo, I think, of medicine. That was what I heard.
Yeah.
And I heard
yeah.
other things, which haven't been substantiated, so I don't want to say them.
Right, of course.
But who cares? Why would I say that if I didn't shut up.
Oh, got a little gossip.
Nah,
huh?
Just
a little something in the chamber, Jim.
I don't like to say rumors like that, because then you fucking put that on somebody if it's
not
true.
Yeah, but you can look up my name and his name, and they'll try to...
Oh, I have.
It looked, even though they didn't say that I was positive, they tried to... allude with the kind of allegedly his girlfriend Mia Isabella or this, that, and the third. But I had never, even my statement that I had given to the public when they contacted me was simply saying he was one of the most incredible friends I've ever had. I was sorry to hear that news about his situation, but I knew that if anybody could handle dealing with this in a major public way, it'd be him because he just doesn't give a fuck a lot of times. He's a strong person. And they took that and tried to say that I was sleeping with him and I scared the Kardashians and the Kylie girl because I was dating Charlie Sheen and Tyga.
Oh, and then that, and that.
And
yeah.
So they started spinning it and it just privately
how
kept
did,
being
how did he
around.
Tell? How did he tell you?
He didn't tell me. I didn't know anything.
Oh, he never told you?
I knew a lot of things about
they
his life,
together.
But I didn't know that. I just knew he was suffering through something really hard by the way he interacted with me and the things he would tell me, but he never told me that.
Have you thought now, after all this stuff that's happened, have you slowed down on having relationships, friendship, or otherwise with celebrities?
I never really wanted to date celebrities at all in
but
general,
you did.
Ever.
So now is it like a thing where you're like, I'm going to, because even if you didn't want to, you didn't avoid it because it just happens.
Right. It's true. You can't help who you like, though.
Right. So is that still where you're at, or are you...
At this point, at first, I was like, I'm never dating a celebrity or anybody in entertainment ever again.
Yeah.
But you can't help who you like. You can't help who you're attracted to. And you can't help who comes after and pursues you. So I can't say that I would never date another celebrity again.
I'd like to date a celebrity.
And I can't say that I'm not dating someone now who's a celebrity. But
I know how to handle things better. You are.
I know how to handle things better.
Who is it?
I'll never tell you.
Oh.
I already know.
Who do you think it is?
You don't know.
I do.
How do you know?
Because I hear
you
things.
You think you know.
No, no, I do.
Who's you? Who have you
think
heard?
You know.
I don't want to say.
Why?
It's Bert Convy.
Is it Bert Convy?
I don't even know who the hell that is.
I had heard it was Bert Convy as well, actually.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Jim's done his research. You want to date a celebrity, Jim?
I do.
What celebrity do you want to date?
I don't care.
You should...
Bert Convy.
No, but I definitely did want to clear that up.
He died in 91.
I've never had a sexual relationship with him, and I was never put at risk. And I
Who, Bert Convy?
No, we know.
Charlie.
Oh.
And I've not, nor have I ever been positive for any diseases. So I want people to know that
good.
This is something that really scared me, especially when you're an adult entertainer or a person who was in the adult entertainment industry. Something like that can destroy your brand completely, whether it's true or
oh,
not.
Yeah, of course.
An allegation, a gossip, anything can ruin your reputation.
A murmur.
A murmur, yeah, all that good stuff.
This is.
Jim was messaging me before the story broke. He's like, I know this big story that's about to break. I know you know something about it, Mia. Tell me.
But I, no,
what's
I didn't
on.
Happen. I asked you if, it, but I asked you off the record. I never would have repeated it. I said, "Are you okay?" Because this whole
right,
thing,
right?
When I found out,
I didn't know who it was. At the
okay,
time.
But I didn't want to. I didn't. Wasn't for the air. It was like in a private chat.
Right.
Like, are you good? And you were like,
I appreciated
mean?
It. Yeah. I really did, but I didn't know what was happening at all, or who it was until it happened. So like the day that it came out, I was just like. Oh, shit.
Right.
That's why he's asking me if I'm okay. Gotcha.
Seems like there's going to be a lot of little tidbits on this podcast
oh,
when it launches.
Oh, there's going to be so, so much.
Jim, have you ever reached out to a celebrity's publicist and been like, I'd like to have dinner with this person?
Yep.
Who have you done that for?
Shit. Scarlett, Charlize Theron.
You did it. You might be aiming a little high.
That's really high.
Yeah, that's what her publicist said. You're aiming really high, Jim.
But then again, you never know. What if she thought that you were cute?
No, the beautiful thing. Here's the difference. I always know. They don't. Yeah. She's so lovely in person, too.
Is she?
Charlize
Theron.
I saw her
in a sushi place once. I wanted to kiss her feet.
Yeah.
I said that out loud, too.
Yeah, that's well, yeah, that's again.
My security.
That's going to work against you, I think.
Yeah,
can I kiss your feet? No, I don't want to date a celebrity. I do, but it's never going to happen.
Why do you say that? With that attitude, Jim.
Sam, nobody wants to be involved with my nonsense. Like, nobody,
that's
the
true.
Things I talk about.
Unless they really got you, though. If they understood your personality, I don't think it would really affect
But who,
them.
Who?
I understand
this
your personality,
fucking
Jim.
Filthy talk. Nobody wants to be, nobody wants to associate with my, do you know how many girls I've lost in fucking, like, Tinder and stuff like that? When I Googled you. That's never good.
And that's the last text.
Yeah, yeah. I'll read one to you.
Yeah, let me hear what it says.
I'll read one. Hold on.
I mean, and by the way, they have every right to do that.
Yeah,
you are.
How about you Google first?
But you see, are a bit of a disgrace.
By you saying that, though, then you have to be able to understand when people can Google me and hear and stuff that they've heard about me, why people would think, oh, I don't want to be associated with that either.
Right.
So I get that.
Yeah.
I understand it.
Yeah. When they Google me, they get some Canadian rock star, so it doesn't.
Here we go.
Doesn't affect me whatsoever.
Talking to this girl, very pretty. Look at how pretty this girl is.
Gorgeous. Again, very high.
Yeah, very
high.
But it's a dating app. Stunning.
Maybe we.
It's a dating app. We were chatting back and forth, going really well. Baba, she's writing good morning, and then I write we should have coffee. Like it's a nice way to meet somebody. You have coffee. There's no pressure. It's not a real date. You go out for lunch. She writes we should. Then the next thing she writes, so I Googled you and found some insane information about your private life preferences.
Oh, okay, oh, well, boy. That makes sense.
And
that
then she writes in parentheses, I'm sure you get this a lot.
And that was it.
And I wrote back, oh, well.
But you gave up. One thing you guys have
no,
to
no,
know,
no, I wrote to her again.
No,
persistence is creepy and rapey. I just wrote her
no,
back.
Persistence works.
I take a hint. No, I take a hint. If they say no, I'm like, all right, whatever. She said no. I wrote her back one time, and then she gave me a write, and then I wrote her back, and then she didn't answer, so I let it go.
Have you looked into that celebrity Tinder app?
I didn't know they had
What's it called?
Like
oh, yeah. I don't remember what it's called. I heard about it from Andrew Schultz. You know who Andrew Schultz is? He's on a celebrity Tinder thing.
Celebrity Tinder.
Do you remember what it's called?
Yeah, that's the one I'm talking about right there. I'm on that. That's the one I'm showing you.
That's well, I'm not on it.
But I am.
Oh, yeah.
A man like me is on it.
Raya is what you're supposed. Yeah, Raya. That's what you're supposed to use.
That's what I'm using.
Oh,
yeah.
And
that's what
they,
this is.
They verify that you are the person. That
and they
you
and
are.
You're still having no luck on it.
None. None.
That's the best. That is the best.
I've had a lot of bullshit on that app, too, though, where you're talking to somebody, and like models, and they're showing interest. And then the second you go, do you want to talk off this app? And I'm pretty good in the app. I'm not creepy. I'm not dirty. Like, if there's one thing I can do, it's hold a conversation. Mm-hmm. And then immediately they don't respond. I'm like, this seems to me like there's been models who are just on this for whatever reason. Like, they don't ever want to have a conversation off the
app.
That's
not true. I do the same tactic with guys all the time. I will not give you my number until we've met. So I'll social media you. I'll Instagram you. I'll do the Snapchatty thing. I'll do all that dating app stuff with you. But I'm not going to talk off the thing until we've agreed to meet, we've met, and I actually feel comfortable with you. Then I give you my number.
There you go, Jim. Looks like you were wrong.
So the persistence actually works, because some guys that I would have never went out with, they just kept bothering me. One day I'm just like, oh, fuck it. Why not?
Do you have any feminists right now who are fucking screaming at the radio?
Whatever. That's not my problem.
But they're like, I don't know. I don't like to be persistent. I like to accept if they say no. I just go whatever, and I just cry and jerk off simultaneously, and that's the end of it. I delete them.
Yeah. Tears make a good lube.
We sure do.
Oh, my God.
You can go to @TheMiaIsabella on Twitter. You can go to Mia Isabella media.com. The podcast is going to be airing on Mia's website later this month. So if you go to MiaIsabellaMedia.com later this month, you'll see the first episode of Since We're Being Honest with Mia and with Al Roker Jr., and she'll get into everything she got into here and a whole lot more.
It's going to be awesome. We'll be on SoundCloud, iTunes, all that kind of stuff.
Oh, great.
And so hashtag Since We're Being Honest.
Mia, thank you so much for coming by.
Thank you.